This video is going to teach you everything you need to know to start working on your own Slint user interface in just 10 minutes. Unlike a programming language that can take ages to get familiar with, Slint offers a simple domain-specific language dedicated just to making user interfaces. We will start with the basic elements, rectangles, text, and images. We just declare these using their name and then open and closed curly braces. You then configure them via properties. Properties are simply structured as the property name, then a colon, then the expression you're setting it to, for example, 30 pics. For clarity, you must finish each property with a semicolon. Slint has an inbuilt live preview. Just click Show Preview to see the real running UI. What about parent-child relationships? Here we create a rectangle. Then we take the text element, and we will cut and paste it within the curly braces of the rectangle. It is now a child of that element. I'm just going to delete the X and Y properties, which means the text element is automatically centered in its parent. Want to declare your own custom properties? Do so with the property keyword, then the property type, give it a friendly name. Then if you need a starting value, add a colon and then the value. And as always, finish with a semicolon. Right now, the user interface is static, so let's make it interactive. We'll make a touch area a child of the rectangle, and it automatically fills its parent. The touch area has a clicked callback. We use it by name, then the equals and greater sign. Then open and closed curly braces, and within the braces, we put an expression that should happen. Let's increment the counter by one on each click. To visualize this, let's put the count on the end of Hello World simply by using the plus operator, which combines two strings together. Now when you click, count is incremented by one, and as count is used in the text, the user interface automatically updates. Evolving your UI quickly is only possible by breaking your interface into separate components. We can already see the start of a button component, so let's formalize it. We define the new component, and then copy-paste the code into it. Errors are because we no longer have access to the count property. Let's just comment out those lines for now. Then tidy up the component by putting the width and height in the root. Now we replace the old code and start typing my button. Autocomplete picks it up and we can see the component is shown. Of course, a real button needs a custom label and it also needs a click callback when clicked or touched. Let's pretend it already has a label property, and you can see it errors, as right now it doesn't. So let's add it. All public properties for customizing a component need to be defined in the root of the element. Here we use in for public and add a property that's a string called label. Then we go to the text element inside of it, and we set its value to be the label property. What about that click callback? Again, in the root of the element, we use the callback keyword and give it a name, such as clicked. Now we go to the internal touch area, and when its clicked callback fires, we call the public one in the root. Now we go back to the main file. We set clicked to increment count, and this time I'm going to use the simpler plus equals operator to increment it by one. Again, we add the count property to the hello text, and we have a fully usable button component. It's more realistic that you're going to want components in separate files, so let's do that. First, I create a new file called mybutton.slint, then cut and paste the code into it. My button cannot be found now, so I delete and start typing it again. This time, autocorrect notices it needs an import and automatically completes the name and adds the import. Slint supports images, including PNGs, JPEGs, and SVGs. Let's drag an SVG into the project to use it. We use Slint's image element. It has a source property, and then we set that to the URL of the image. Nothing shows. Each subsequent element you define in the Slint file is on top of the previous one, so my button is covering the image. Let's move it down. Now the button is off screen, so let's bring it back by subtracting first its own height and then a margin of 16 pixels. As well as needing reusable components, you are also going to want to have reusable properties, for example, a color palette or sizes such as margins. Let's create that right now. We create a file called styles.slint, and in it we're going to export a new type called global. We call it styles, and we're going to add our margin property. Here we use the out keyword because we want it to be a read-only property. It's a length and has a name of margin, and again, it'll be 16 pixels. Now we're going back to the main file, and we're going to import the styles. And then instead of 16 pixels, we write styles, and autocomplete finds the margin, and now we're using the shared value. Impressed? Why don't we make this into a ratings app, where you can give it 1 to 5 stars? You can repeat elements based on a model here. So I'm going to use the count property as the model. Then we write for I, with I being each value in count, from 0 to 4, and then it repeats the image. Let's give it a click. One image appears, but then no more. This is because they're all overlapping. So let's put this into a horizontal layout. Better. But now we're seeing some size issues. As we're going to have 5 stars, let's just make the image width the root width divided by 5. Let's tidy up the logic so if the count gets higher than 5, it loops back to 0. I'm going to add some informative text telling you to rate the demo. Then I want to change the button to just be a plus symbol. It now looks bad and oversized, so let's go back to the component. It would be great if we could bind the width of the button to be the same width as the label, plus a sensible margin. To do this, the text element needs an identifier. We do this by writing the identifier name and then colon equals. So then on the root width, we can write myText.width. But we also want a bit of a margin either side, so I'm going to use the margins from the style object and multiply it by 2. Then we do the same thing for the height. This button still isn't looking clear enough, so I'm going to make the font weight heavier. The gradient API in Slint is very similar to the CSS gradient, so I'm going to use this website to grab a nice one, then add it to the global styles and call it fun gradient. Back to the button component and let's use this gradient. Finally, let's use the border radius property to give the button slightly rounded corners. Let's now polish this off. It's not obvious that you can rate this out of 5 stars, so let's first give a hint by adding in 5 white Slint logos. Easily done by again repeating the image 5 times, then using the colorize property to make it white. I'm going to add a border to frame the demo, and now a touch of animation. Previously, each of the blue logos were created every time we click the plus button. That's going to interfere with the animation. So now I'm going to have all 5 items drawn at the beginning. Then declare an expression on their opacity. So if the count is greater than the index of I, the opacity will be 1, and if it's not, it'll be 0. And we can do that with a simple ternary statement. However, the opacity is going to change instantly. We want it to animate. Just use the animate keyword, then the names of the properties you want to animate, then open and close curly braces. Within these, we set a duration property, and I'm going to set it to 500 milliseconds. That's not enough though. I think it would be a bit better to animate the width, so I'm going to use a similar binding. So now when count is greater than I, the size of the width will be root.width divided by 5, and if not, it will be 0. And I'll add width to the animate values. There are no limits on the types of interface or products you can build with Slint. So this concludes the 10-minute introduction, and I hope you can see that the Slint declarative UI language is simple, easy to pick up, and powerful.